But that was a lovely morning, wasn't it? Eraldine and a walk around Coringai. I think that was really interesting. I hope everyone enjoyed it. So please feel free to ask questions during it. Some of this might be a little bit repetitive because I'm just going to run through the structure of the Land Environment Court and who the decision makers and the judges are and things like that. So I'll do that fairly quickly because I know you've heard a little bit about the Land Environment Court yesterday and in the previous day. So, as you probably know, it was established in 1979 and it's equal to the Supreme Court as the court of record. There are six judges, including the chief judge, and at the moment there are seven commissioners. We're hoping for some more, and we have in the past had about nine commissioners, so it means that the lists are a little bit slower at the moment because there's just a greater workload than seven can cope with, so it means that the matters tend to get pushed out a little bit. We've got 14 acting commissioners, and I'll talk a little bit more about them in a minute, and the registrar and the assistant registrar. So as you probably know, the classes, the jurisdiction of the court's divided into classes. That's because, of course, it's got a tribunal function, which is the merits appeal, which are in classes 1, 2 and 3, and then it's also got the court functions, judicial review and appeals and things in the other classes. So I'll talk a little bit more about those as well. So in the merits appeals, they can be heard by a judge. They're most often heard by a commissioner sitting alone, but occasionally you might get a judge assisted by a commissioner in a bigger appeal from, let's say, an objector appeal for a mine or something like that. Sometimes a judge will hear that and then might be assisted by a commissioner who has expertise in a particular area. The rules of evidence aren't binding, so typical of tribunals, and the conciliation conferences are used as a mandatory form of alternative dispute resolution. So I'll talk a little bit more about that as well. And then in the classes 4, 5, 6 and 7, you've got a judge hearing them, and in class 8, which is the mining jurisdiction, there's a judge or a mining commissioner. A mining commissioner is one of the commissioners with legal qualifications. So there's the senior commissioner and six commissioners at the moment. The commissioners have a range of expertise and experience, including law and planning and architecture, like me, and heritage. And one of our full-time commissioners is a tree expert. There are 14 acting commissioners. Now, those commissioners generally have very particular expertise. So it might be an Aboriginal heritage or in archaeology or some particular area where they're brought in when there's a case dealing with that particular area of expertise. And they might sometimes sit with a judge and give advice to the judge during the hearing of that, or assist in that hearing. They might also hear a matter on their own as an acting commissioner, or they might sit with a full-time commissioner. So that's up to the chief judge how it's done. The cases are all allocated by the chief judge. Generally, I believe he allocates them according to the expertise of the commissioner, but of course that's not always possible, and sometimes you'll be hearing a matter that's not, you don't have a background in that particular area, but so the commissioners can do all the matters. Most of the time in Class 1, parties are represented by either a solicitor or by a barrister, briefed by a solicitor or a firm. But they can be sometimes represented by an agent, and in the tree matters that happens much more often, so I think it's mostly people are either self-represented or they're represented by an agent in the tree matters, but in the appeals from development applications to council, for example, generally they'll have a solicitor, and council has retained a couple of firms as solicitors normally, or some councils have their own in-house solicitors and they will appear for the council. Just an interesting thing is that the court does sit at local courts all around, so the court being in the merits appeals and in the other matters, but generally if we have a matter in the country, we'll sit in that local court in that area. So we might be up at Tweed Heads, or we might be at Wollongong, or further south. So we go all over New South Wales, because that's, of course, the jurisdiction is New South Wales, and sit in other courts. And the other, to make it accessible, directions hearings are sometimes done by telephone, so it might be hearing in court before the registrar, but it might also be by telephone if it's a country matter. So on Mondays, the assistant registrar does all the country matters and does it all by telephone with the party, so that both parties are on the line and they're able to appear before the assistant commissioner that way, and that makes it also accessible, affordable and convenient for the parties. The parties also communicate now by e-court, which is just email. It comes in and it's all recorded, and a record is kept of all of those e-courts that are sent, and the court communicates with the parties by email as well. So again, it's all recorded under the in the record section of the court, so that they're easily accessed by the commissioner or the judge hearing the matter. So a lot of communication now is all done that way, and not necessarily by appearing in person. So we do get a lot of heritage matters, or heritage issues in particular matters before the court. I'm going to be talking about Class 1 today, so the merits appeals in relation to a development application most often, or sometimes it might be an order that council's issued, or it might be a valuation matter in Class 3. Class 4 is the judicial review class, and Class 5 is criminal proceedings. So again, in all of those, you might end up having to deal with heritage matters, heritage issues. So in the Class 1 jurisdiction, the court's regularly required to deal with heritage issues, and I'm going to talk about a couple of those cases today. It's usually in relation to a desire to demolish or alter or develop a heritage listed property, or it might be a property within a heritage conservation area. And most of the time, these cases raise questions of the heritage significance of the particular item, and that's what we're looking at. And I assumed that someone would be talking to you about heritage assessment, so I might talk a little bit about that. I don't have a slide on it, but just to explain how that process is done by generally by heritage consultants, that sometimes they might have an architectural background or a geographic background, or there's different backgrounds that people end up going into heritage and having expertise in that area. And I will talk a little bit about doing heritage assessments. So heritage issues in obviously judicial review, there might be heritage issues such as a challenge to the validity of a consent or a permit to destroy or demolish a heritage item. This is just an image of Hill End, one of the properties in Hill End that's protected, or an Aboriginal object as well. Our website is a great resource for you in anything you're looking to find out about the court. So as you can see, all the judges and the commissioners and the acting commissioners, biographies and information about the people making decisions are on the court, so that can be quite useful if you're appearing in the court, just to understand the background of the person, particularly for the commissioners obviously, of the person before whom you're appearing. All the cases that are relevant to particular issues are listed on the court, so you'll see if you go to your legal problem is about, there's a whole list of different categories, and the commissioners and judges update those lists fairly regularly, and you'll see there's a heritage a list, and those cases are listed under, which I'll go through a little bit, they're listed under the listing of the listing of the item. So the cases relating to heritage items are separated from the cases relating to heritage conservation areas, for example. And then it goes into if you want to demolish a heritage item. So all those cases are separated out. So there's quite a good resource there if you're dealing with any of those sort of issues. You can go and see how some of those matters have been decided in the past by the court. So that can be quite a useful resource in doing some research. So generally most matters in the merits appeal start on site, so wherever it is, it's in Sydney, or it might be, as I said, in the country. They start on site at 9:30, and the commissioner will hear from any objectors. So objectors are notified of an appeal in relation to, let's say, a development refusal from council, and the objectors can come and give lay evidence at the commencement of the hearing on site. The matter generally goes to mandatory conciliation first, so we'll hear from the objectors on site and what their issues are. We'll then, if it's depending on the type of matter it is, we'll then have a conciliation conference. That's usually confidential between the parties. It's a process of whether there are some amendments to the proposal that might allow the parties to come to an agreement. And if that's the case, the Commissioner will dispose of the matter with a Section 34 orders and a judgment. Where the Commissioner's not actually making an assessment of the proposal, it's just a matter of whether it's a legal decision that the court might have come to anyway. And the parties in that sense have some control over the outcome. There's no judgment in terms of dealing with the merits of the issue. So some parties prefer to to resolve the matter in that way, and because it doesn't have to go to a contested hearing. I think it's something like 79% of our matters at the court don't reach arbitration, don't reach a contested hearing, but they're resolved either mostly by the conciliation conference or sometimes discontinued or for other reasons that they don't progress to a hearing. I think that's everything there. We've got experts in all different matters. So depending on what the issues are in the merits appeal, it might be a traffic issue. It might be the council raises those issues in their statement of facts and contentions, and the applicant will then respond to what those contentions are that council has raised. So obviously there might be heritage issues, but there might also be traffic, there might be planning issues, and each party will generally have an expert in relation to the issues that are raised, and they'll confer with each other before the hearing or before the conciliation. They'll prepare what's called a joint report, and they'll explore if there are any amendments to the proposal that might allow them to come to agreement over one of the contentions. So in that way, in a conciliation conference, often matters are narrowed because the experts reach agreement over certain issues, and only the issues that are not agreed upon end up going to a contested hearing. There's quite a lot of information again on the court website about experts, what their duties are under the procedural rules, and joint reports. There's guide on to how to prepare a joint report. So again, there's a lot of information there for people who are appearing as an expert witness at the court. So heritage listings, just to give you a bit of an idea, as we heard at Araldine, there's obviously a national list. There's the State Heritage Register, which is available on the Heritage website and under the Environment and Heritage Department. And then there's heritage lists in the local environment plans, which is called a local heritage item. And then there are heritage conservation areas, which are large areas that are designated by councils to be of heritage significance as a collective whole. The New South Wales State Heritage Register is available online, and those items are protected under the Heritage Act. There's quite different provisions under the Heritage Act to what there are under the Environmental Planning and Assessment Act. So, for example, there's different there's funding available under the Heritage Act, which you wouldn't be able to get for a local heritage item. This is one of the City of Sydney. In their LEP, this is one of their maps. So it just gives you an idea of how the heritage said this is how many maps there'll be when you go, and that's all available on the New South Wales legislation website. When you get to environmental planning instruments on the legislation website that you're probably familiar with, if you go to Sydney City Council, you'll get the LEPs or whichever council you're going to, And when you open up the LEP, you'll see there's a little icon at the top which gives the maps. So the maps are just showing you visually what's in the provisions or in the schedules of the local environment plan. So for example, here's one map. So this is the City of Sydney area. This is the one map up here. The red hatched area is the heritage conservation area. So you can see that's a large part of Sydney. And the shaded areas are the heritage items. So just gives you an idea of how they depict it. So, and then you'll get maps, of course, for height and floor space ratio and all the other development standards that are included in the local environment plan. I thought I'd talk a little bit about planning principles. So at the court has planning principles, which again are on the court's website. They're contained within a decision, and it's usually based on criteria that has wider application to other cases. They're not intended to direct an outcome, but to structure the reasoning process in relation to that particular issue. And they elaborate on the reasoning with regard to that particular issue. The idea of the planning principles was to encourage consistency in decision making between commissioners. As you probably know, if you've done administrative law, the idea of court, of a tribunal or court producing their own principles can be controversial sometimes, and there has been some controversy with the planning principles. Some people are quite critical of them, and I think most of the practitioners find them quite useful. One that's used very regularly is one called tenacity. So if you go onto the court's website, go onto planning principles, you'll see they're all listed as the case name, and the one that's tenacity is about views, and it's a way of assessing the importance of a view, whether it's over a side boundary or a rear boundary, whether it's standing or sitting, whether it's of the harbour and the opera house, or all sorts of things like that. So it was a way of providing some objectivity to the concept in council's documents of view sharing, which was not further elaborated on, but most councils said that they valued view sharing, but there was no real way of measuring that. So the senior commissioner at the time developed a planning principle called tenacity, and we probably deal with that once every 2 weeks or something like this, so very, very regularly. Sometimes the experts will give a lot of weight to the planning principle, and they, you know, pore over it, and probably when they should be thinking more specifically about the particular issues in that case, or perhaps some of the provisions of the LEP or the controls in the development control plan, they're not always aware or thinking about the hierarchy of those sorts of planning controls, where the planning principle comes at the bottom of that. But because the court formulated it, I think they give a lot of weight to it, and you get a lot of evidence on particular planning principles, and often the representatives of each party will hand up some of those previous decisions in regard to planning principles. So they're referred to very regularly in the merits appeals. There has been a bit of a process on at the court to refine and think again about some of those planning principles. So our recent senior commissioner, who's recently been appointed a judge, Justice Moore, he went through the planning principles with all the commissioners, and we talked about ones that weren't used very much and ones that could probably be deleted. So we're going through a process at the moment of taking some of those down and not having them as planning principles anymore. There is one heritage planning principle which is called Hello, which is of course named after the case that it's in, and again that's available on the website if you go to planning principles. It's the only heritage planning principle, and it looks at the economics of retaining a dwelling in a heritage conservation area. It's really a cost-benefit analysis of the cost to keep that house, and what the benefits are, and the applicant sought the demolition of the dwelling, and it was identified as a contributory to the heritage conservation area in Strathfield. And the applicant justified the demolition of the dwelling on the basis of its structural rectification, and it would be too expensive. So they ended up getting the structural engineers to come and do, so council got an expert and the applicant got an expert, and they both priced those structural rectifications that were required for the dwelling, and I think it came somewhere in the 300,000 range at that time. And the commissioner then looked at the significance of the, you know, its contribution to the heritage conservation area, and whether it could be extended and sympathetically, and the building retained. And he came to a decision that it could be, and then that was that became a heritage planning principle. That's been used in some of the applications for demolition of a heritage item. So even that is a little bit controversial. It was really intended to be used for heritage conservation areas, and then it's been raised in the demolition of a heritage item, which I'm going to talk about some of those cases. So just before I go on with the heritage cases, I might just have it just explain to you how heritage assessments are done. Under the Environment and Heritage Department's website, they have publications that are quite easy to find, and you'll find one there called Assessing Heritage Significance. And so heritage experts use that document particularly, and it has a number, I think it's five areas of significance, which will be aesthetic, technical, scientific, social, and an item need only be significant under one of those headings to warrant listing as a heritage item. So there's a whole, of course, you know, there's a whole degree you can do on that whole process. So it's difficult to explain it quickly, but that's how they do assessments. And then there's level of significance. So again, it'll have to reach a certain threshold to be to warrant being listed as a heritage item. So I'll be generally talking about houses today, but a heritage item might be an Aboriginal site. It might be, as we saw today, the Little Garland Island associated with Bradfield. It can be all sorts of things that are listed as heritage items, and they might be in council's own ownership. So like the little garden today is probably comes under RMS, I'd say, and so there's all sorts of different situations where you might end up with a heritage item. So I'll talk about some of the heritage cases. So this is one that, this is a recent judgment. It was a demolition of a heritage item in Strathfield. I don't know why Strathfield features so prominently in people wanting to demolish things, but this is quite a well-documented case, like some are at the court, because the owner was, I think, the mayor of the council, or recent mayor of the council, and he'd bought this property. It's on three different allotments, so, and he obviously had a plan to develop that site, and so he just let the house deteriorate, which is a common, or not common, but it does occasionally happen when somebody would prefer to demolish their heritage item. They might just not repair it, let it deteriorate. So this is what happened in this case. He came to the council originally with a, so this is the house obviously before anything happened to it, and this is the house at the time of the hearing at court. Originally he went to the council with a proposal to demolish the house, and that was refused, and then mysteriously enough there was a fire in the house, and the house was not insured, and as you can see the house sustained quite significant damage at that point, and exacerbated by the fact that it wasn't repaired in any sense, so that there was water getting in every time it rained, and the deterioration was quite rapid at that, you know, from that point onwards. He then put another application into council to demolish the house. Council refused it, and he appealed that refusal to the Land and Environment Court. The house is called Camden Lodge, and it's a local heritage item. Part of the justification for demolition was that the house wasn't insured at the time of the fire, that the cost of rectifying the house was in the 1.5 to 1.7, or reinstating, you know, the house, was a significant cost, and that it wasn't justified in the case of what was left of the house. And just to say a little bit about that, so there's also a document called the Borough Charter you might have heard of, and the Borough Charter has a whole lot of guides for different definitions. So if you're using definitions in relation to restoration, conservation, all those words, it's very important to use those particular definitions, because then everybody knows you're talking about the same thing. So there's also an argument about to what extent you restored the house into, you know, it was obviously going to be new fabric, because the old fabric, a lot of it for the roof, for example, would need to be replaced with new fabric. The heritage experts who gave evidence in this case agreed that the house didn't need to be taken back to, say, the Araldine Museum level of reinstatement, that it could be quite a new interior, it could be, but that the overall appearance and form and external envelope of the house should be reinstated. And for example, say the slate roof should be, and the roof framing should all be reinstated, and the house should look generally as it did look, but that you could do something quite contemporary inside. So that, you know, it was a bit of a middle ground there. It wasn't suggesting that it had to be at museum quality or completely reinstated internally. So the commissioner was weighing up then this cost, this significant cost of doing that to the house, of repairing the house and fitting it out, with the demolition and redevelopment of the site. And she came to the conclusion that, weighing up all the evidence, that if you demolish the house, it would completely destroy its heritage significance inevitably, and it wasn't warranted that the reconstruction, so as to retain its heritage significance, was a reasonable requirement, and that there was the possibility of selling one of the allotments that was not that the house was not attached to, and that they might be able to raise some of the funds needed to restore the house from that sale. So that was quite an important decision. And then this is another one in Strathfield. Not that I'm picking on Strathfield, but yeah, sure. Yeah.
When the house was built, you probably said this, but I didn't pay attention. There was a heritage.
It was heritage listed a long time. I think it was built in 1916 on three allotments. So it's a, it's a bungalow style, but a lot of Federation influence. So it's why it's got a Federation look. But there's some very beautiful houses in Strathfield if you wander around there. And this was a period of development there, and so that's quite a homogenous style for what's left of. Because this development, like Paddington in the Victorian period in the 1890s, happened in a very short period of time, you get quite an interesting houses that all seem to have a relationship to each other in terms of style and architectural style. And then also, I think they were, you know, it was expensive construction in its day, so they were beautifully done. And
the reason I ask that, of course, is that it's ironic that the house is called the purchaser,
obviously that didn't come into it in terms of the hearing and demolition, but I think there was no cause determined, is I think that how it was worded, something like that.
So in terms of unreasonable burden, Lord Fletcher's, which is the first one we're talking about, actually caused
I think that's the planner. So sometimes the appeal won't be in the name of the owner of the property. So just be a doobie.
Well, we'll just say the owner of the house had caused some of the unreasonable costs. So I'm happy with the decision. That would be a factor in.
I think. for the sake of, I mean, I know myself, it was just taken as a fait accompli as where the house was, and if you probably gave that any weight, it might be a ground of appeal, and I'm guessing here, but I'd be a bit cautious about, you know, that kind of idea of retribution, because that's a different domain, isn't it, in a legal sense?
In terms of defining what's unreasonable cost.
Yeah, I think she did. I think she said, look, you know, something to the effect of, if you don't insure the house, it's not something I can take into account particularly. You know, it's just a fact. And I mean, I had one recently where one of the parties put on an affidavit about the cost. I won't say what it's for, but it's just for a development, and they haven't bought the actual site. They've got some way of holding it for this development until they get consent, and they've appealed a refusal, and they've obviously got holding costs related to that development, and they put on an affidavit regarding the cost to them, but I wouldn't give that very much weight, because if any, because that's the risk of development, you know, and that's not something that I'd take into account in making those sort of decisions. You'd be looking more at the provisions and the, you know, the legal context that you're in, not really what the cost is to the. But again, this is something interesting. And the other interesting thing about the Helou planning principle that's come through in this decision, and that idea of a cost-benefit analysis, it's not something that happens at councils. So when council's refusing a development for demolition of this house, they're not looking at the cost at all. And so one of the criticisms of the planning principles, and Helou particularly, is that it brings into the play another issue, another construct that's not something that the council is dealing with. So, but often really what's happened with the planning principles is they have given a lot of guidance to councils, and they have tended then to come through into development control plans. And interestingly, I think last time I saw Sutherland, it had the tenacity planning principle with no reference to where it came from, but just all in there as if they'd sort of dreamt it up. And so, you know, they're often not even cited as to where they come from. And then other councils like Willara will actually just specifically, which is probably a smarter way to do it, they'll refer to the court's planning principle so that if it's updated or changed, it, you know, automatically is updated. The problem with sort of cutting and pasting from here to here is if there's a change over here, well then, you know, it's an issue. So that's just a, Well, the commissioner that heard that, Commissioner Pearson, she drove past it recently. So just when she was chatting to me, she said that it's still in much the same state. So one of the issues with heritage items, local heritage items, is that the council has put an order on. Now, I don't know what the outcome of that is, but the council gave them an order to put a tarpaulin and cover the house. And I believe that hasn't happened, but I don't know. You know, that's just hearsay. I really don't know what's happened with that. But under the Heritage Act, if you've got a state heritage item, the government's got a lot more power to require an owner to perform necessary maintenance and to conserve what fabric's there, whereas you don't have any of that under the Environmental Planning and Assessment Act.
Did you say the commissioner?
Yeah. She just said, there was an order put on it, but the appeal was about the demolition and refusal by council. So the appeal was just a refusal of a DA, but I believe council had put on an order. So as I said, I don't know what the outcome of that was or what happened, because you can appeal an order, but that wasn't an order appeal, that was an appeal from the development application. So this is another one. This is much the same issue. This is a John Brogan house. He was an architect in the 30s, and talking about women and university this morning at Araldine, Florence Taylor was the first female architect to graduate, and I think it was about the same time, 1920s or something. And she was a very good friend of John Brogan's, and she did a lot of writing about architecture, and she wrote about his houses and apartments he did sometimes. The interesting thing about John Brogan, his son was an architect, I think, and his granddaughters, I think there's a couple of granddaughters that I was at uni with who were architects. And he was very clever at doing a fantastic plan, and then he could cloak it in whatever style the owner wanted. So he's often associated with this Tudor, you know, Tudor-esque sort of style, because people thought that was, or it's often called lawyers, no, it's got some funny name that they, I can't think what it is now, it was seen as prestigious and fitting to the status of the person who was the client in commissioning the work. So this is quite a prominent site at in Strathfield. Again, it's on a corner site. It's a heritage item. It relates to a number of houses nearby. That it's a little bit later than the house we just saw. It's 1930s. And it had a beautiful garden and some significant trees. The owner, I believe the owner before this case did get, just out of interest, he did get a development approval for an addition at the back, but just didn't know where to stop and completely gutted this house. And as you can see, there's, you know, demolished all the garden, you know, retaining walls, everything. And when you go in, there's, you know, even some of the floorboards aren't there, so there's no plaster on the walls, there's no joinery, there's no ceilings, there's just the actual bare structure, and in some spots there's some floorboards, but not in all, and the staircase was still there. The whole back wall was gone, but I think part of that was they did have consent for. So in that state, the owner sold it to a new owner, and the new owner then put in a development application to demolish the dwelling, and similarly council refused it, and similarly that new owner appealed that to the court. You know, this is one I heard, and we went through the same cost benefit analysis, so the cost of the work, what state it had to be, but you know, if it could be a contemporary interiors, which both heritage experts agreed it could be, you know, deciding that it was feasible and warranted to reconstruct it, that it would, obviously it would have no heritage significance if it wasn't reconstructed, and that the cost was, and it was very poor, the evidence before me was very poor, not from the quanti surveyor's point of view, he did what he was asked to do, but what he was asked to do was completely insufficient to really make much of an assessment of. It was, it wasn't really measuring the difference between retaining and not retaining the house, so you'd have to read the decision. But I think if you're going to start arguing, you know, unreasonable cost burden, you've got to do that very effectively in terms of evidence, and that's certainly not what's happening. But maybe that's where we're going. It's, you know, wait and see with the next few cases. So this is a different case. This is Tarramurra, so again, not too far away, and. This was an appeal against an interim heritage order. So the council has the power delegated from the minister to put to make an interim heritage order on something that's not listed as a heritage item, but the council believes is under threat. This property is on four allotments, and the council's committee thought that it might be an F. Glyn Gilling house. And he's a very prominent, again, early 20th century architect that did quite grand and beautiful houses, very, you know, recognised architect from the firm Jocelyn & Gilling. And so the idea of an interim heritage order is, and it's made under the Heritage Act, is that a provision in the Heritage Act that it gives the council or the applicant time to do some more research and decide if the property is worth listing as a heritage item. So it just buys them a little bit of time. That research was done, and both architect for the council and, or heritage, there were heritage consultants, but both architects. The heritage consultants for both the council and the applicant agreed that the house itself was designed by Carlisle Greenwell, who was the uncle of the owner at the time, and it was not an F. Glyn Gilling house, that it was not worthy of a local heritage listing, so that was agreed. But what they disagreed about was the level of significance of the garden. So there was a beautiful little sunken garden to the side of the dwelling, and the expert for the council decided that should be listed, that the whole site should be listed for the sake of this sunken garden. and I heard this one as well, so that IHO was revoked because the purpose of it was to discover whether it was an F. Glenn Gilling house, that the evidence was that the garden didn't reach the threshold for listing, and that the IHO had served its purpose in allowing for that research to be done, and that research had not proved to be what they suspected. So the IHO was revoked, and then a month later there was a hearing for the appeal against the development that was the original proposal. So that was being held up waiting for that decision on the IHO. So this one, this one's often mentioned. This was a demolition of a contributory item in Mossman in a heritage conservation area. It was, as I said, identified as contributory to the area. So heritage conservation areas are sometimes listed now in the schedule of the local environment plan, but the identification of contributory items are not always done by all councils, so it depends on the conservation area. And that's all done as part of the development control plan, so it's not a statutory list in that sense. And I thought it's also worth mentioning this morning, I think someone mentioned the Institute of Architects has their own list of significant buildings, and again that's not a statutory list, but it's a list that tends to inform councils about what might be significant in the area. So it's a valuable list, and it's something we might have some regard to, but not it's not the same weight you'd give to a identified heritage item in a local environment plan. That's really up to the council if they decide that it's of significance and they want to list it. And many contemporary buildings appear on that, architects particularly, on the Institute of Architects list, because a lot of councils haven't done their contemporary architecture studies, and so Woollahra Council have done a contemporary, I think they were the first council about 15 years ago to do a contemporary heritage list and look at, because in that area a number of interesting architects such as Glenn Murcutt and Sydney Anker, who was mentioned today in relation to that original library when we did the walk, that modern building next to the Federation building at the top of Gordon. Their work, they did a lot of work in Woollahra as well, and in Ku-ring-gai and other areas, and so Woollahra have listed, I think they did a study of 40 buildings and listed about 20 of them, so they got Clive Lucas Stapleton to do the study and do all the research, and interestingly spoke to the architects as well about their own buildings and how intact they were and what their thoughts were about the significance of those particular examples in their body of work. So it's a very interesting study, and perhaps, I'm not sure if Ku-ring-gai's done their done a contemporary architecture study, but that might be also a reason why that Anchor Wart, not a woolly building that we looked at this morning, might not be listed for that reason. I'm not sure if she said it was listed or not, but so that's a process, an ongoing process, and of course all of this depends on council's resources, and they need money to fund those studies. Generally those studies are done by private firms of architects or heritage consultants, so they're costly, and that's something that needs to be planned for. And so things that are not listed, there's certainly not a line in the sand as to what gets listed and what doesn't. Often you see a building that's not listed and wonder why it's not, because it appears to be of significance. And other times you see things that are listed that perhaps have been altered and changed to the extent that they no longer warrant heritage listing. And the reason for that is, it's resources of the council that, when all those lists first came in the early 80s, things got listed, and sometimes those lists haven't been reviewed at all in all those years. So there's certainly a place for putting some resources to reviewing what's on heritage lists, and that's almost never done. So those things can sometimes end up at the court because somebody wants to make a change to one of those buildings, or believes that it's not of the significance. So not that the court can take it off a list, but it means that you might get development consent for something that a council might not have given it development consent for in relation to believing it to be of significance because it's on the LEP list. So this one was, this is a heritage conservation area in Mossman, as I said, Bradley's Head Road, heritage conservation area. Again, this was an area that developed rapidly in Federation period, so there's lots of very grand Federation houses that, so next door to this one on the left side looking at that photo is a heritage item, a very grand Federation house. Part of the argument there were these contributory items provide the character and the context to those heritage items. And certainly that's the case in this case. This particular house, just to explain, is quite far back on the site. So you see it has quite, it's a little bit hard to tell from that photo, but it has quite a significant setback from the street, and then it's a little bit tight at the back. And the owner who purchased the house first of all looked at doing, and it's also had that sort of rather, this is an addition that's a bit, you know, out of keeping really in terms of proportion. But it's listed as a contributory item, and the owner wanted to demolish it because they wanted to locate a new house further forward on the site. The council refused it. In this particular one, in the negotiations with council, it got a little bit confused, I think, with discussing what the replacement building was. So council was giving them the message that if you replace it with something we're happy with, we'll let you replace it. That really shouldn't be the question. The question is, can you demolish it or not demolish it, as a first question, and when you finish that and make a decision you can, then you might talk about what the replacement building is. But it's often been conflated, you know, and I think that's a mistake, and it's confusing, and it sends the wrong message to people, and they spend a lot of money getting a design and negotiating over that when, you know, the first question is going to be no, potentially, and then, you know, in terms of resources, it's a very poor use of resources. So this one, they also do, this is another interesting thing, the heritage assessment criteria that I spoke about, which is in that assessing heritage significance document that's published by the heritage branch, which is part of the Environment and Heritage Department, that's used by heritage consultants, was used to, so there's a whole lot of criteria that a heritage consultant will go down and decide whether something's of heritage significance, worthy of listing as a heritage item. But what sometimes happens is a heritage consultant for the applicant will use that criteria and then say, look, it's not worthy of listing as a heritage item, so it can be demolished. But obviously if it's listed as a contributory item in a heritage conservation area, it's not about the individual significance of that building, because by definition it's not worthy of being a heritage item. The council's probably already made that assessment, and that's why it's listed as a contributory item in the HCA. And so using the heritage criteria to justify the demolition is, you know, a little bit, it's nothing wrong with using the heritage criteria and deciding why it's significant, but really you should apply that to the whole collective heritage conservation area if you're going to say what the significance is, and you can't use it to justify the demolition of a contributory item, because it's really used, it's really the intention of it is to identify items of significance worthy of a local heritage listing. So I hope that's not too confusing, but that, you know, I think it's an interesting issue because it's very often done with councils, and I think it sort of muddies the waters, and people think, oh well, it's not a significance, so it can be demolished. So that one was again refused on the basis that it would diminish the historic and aesthetic values of the heritage conservation area, and importantly its collective significance, because that's why it's, and that there was ample scope for alterations and additions to this building. You could do quite a lot with it, turn it, you know, it didn't preclude making an addition that would make it very desirable and adequate for contemporary living. So it was just those particular owners. I often, you know, my personal view is that with heritage houses or contributory items in HCA, if you get the right owner, it doesn't matter what listings you put on things, but if you get the right owner, you get a great outcome. And if you get the wrong owner, no matter what you try to do, and it does help, but really, people should be quite cognizant of what they purchase. You know, if it's not your thing to do the heritage, home and enjoy that, then you're better to get something older. And you do want to redevelop, then you get something that would be ideal to redevelop, and not necessarily a contributory item or a heritage item in a heritage conservation area. So this is another one. This is alterations and additions to a contributor chart, and this is a little cottage in Willara, typical of those sort of little workers' cottages. It was quite a big addition at the back, so all of that was fine, and because it, again, it's a contributor item in a heritage conservation area, and you know, they're quite, you can deal quite robustly with those buildings. So it was retaining the cottage and the front two rooms, but doing something quite contemporary and interesting at the rear. But the parking, well, what the applicant was really after was parking in the front setback, and that was refused. So, and that's a common issue in those sorts of areas. And again, it's on a case-by-case basis. Sometimes in certain areas it's approved. This won't be the level. It probably was up, you know, this has all been added at some point. So, but it's not the fact that what's there, it was just that it had the front fence and it was a cottage with a garden at the front, and it's in a row of cottages with gardens. So there was the odd parking in the front setback that had been approved at some time in the street. And so the parties will, you know, particularly the applicant obviously, will take you around and show you those examples. But in this case, it would have really eroded the significance that the little cottage made to the street and that idea of its front garden and how it was once used. And unfortunately for this owner, it didn't have rear lane access. So ideally in Paddington and Willara, Willara Council tries to only have parking from the rear laneway so that you retain that, you know, appeal and character in the street front. So, and it would have eroded that, so that's why it was refused. He sold it, actually. I noticed it was for sale after that, so. But, because it's hard to park, it's in Holdsworth Street, it's hard to park in that street. No, it was actually, I think you had to take out from memory, this is often what they do with these front parking, because there really isn't enough room. I can't remember where the fence is, but I think they had to take out all of this and, you know, get the car in that way. It's usually they don't fit. You really need, you know, 5 to 6 metres, like 6 metres ideally to get it. I've had ones in Bondi, you know, where they were actually taking out the front section of the house and then putting a lintel in and then driving in under, you know, it's... I don't know. The problem is these are, you know, to some extent, these are philosophical questions. I think in this particular instance, the development control plan at Willara had been consistently applied, and so, you know, I gave that quite a lot of weight in terms of Stockland, one of the decisions, that Willara consistently don't let parking in the front of cottages like this, and that's why, you know, Willara, the suburb, has that particular character, because whereas there are some areas, say in Waverley, where they've all got parking, and I've approved and other people parking in the front setback in those areas when it's the last house, or it's, you know, there's quite a few, or yeah. So it is a judgment call, isn't it? And different people will draw the line at different spots, so it, you know, that can be one of the criticisms.
I'll bring up the issue and make up answer to my own question about responsibilities of solicitors involved in the landscape. And if you have an item like this, your light's flashing about there must be something significant about you know, the responsibilities of what you do with that sort of property. And you may not know the answer, you might be an expert in this area, but you should do some more research for your client. So your client is purchasing something with the expectation that you use it in a particular way, and then find out when they bought it, oh, actually, now I can't do this. So it looks like... And it could be the clients as well.
Oh, I think mostly, and particularly in Willara, they're pretty savvy. They just, you know, it's suddenly worth a lot more if you can get the parking, and it's a place without parking, and it's Holdsworth Street. It's a short walk up to the Willara shops. And so the difficulty here was that there'd been a decision by the senior commissioner around the corner where he'd allowed parking in the front setback of a heritage item. And so they, you know, were citing that case, and I think that gave them some hope. And that's another example of where, you know, Willara has tried very hard to confine parking to the laneways or access from laneways, to not have parking in the front setbacks. And if one decision like that then can create an expectation that it might be given. So I just distinguished this situation from that situation and went along that way and gave the fact that Woollahra consistently applied their DCP weight. And so
I think also just Len's observation of the planning principles. I mean, as law students, you're aware of the ratio density principle of applying precedents from higher courts. And in this case, it's a type of precedent, but it might be on the same level using international judgments or decisions on the same level.
Yeah, you're not bound, but yeah. Yeah.
Some people must think it's a definite precedent that you must follow, and therefore they put that necessary weight. And therefore, your legal advisors have got to explain that.
That's
it would be better to say, this is a guide, but using this sort of case, you're guaranteed to have the same outcome because you've got a different person, you've got other factors.
And there's also a very important case by the Court of Appeal, Siegel and Waverley, which I know Judith will be familiar with. And that was a decision where the Court of Appeal said, and it was it's an interesting case in itself. It was in Bronte. It was, if you know Bronte, they often have the sandstone retaining walls that were built early in the 20th century. And these two different, I think they were close by, wanted parking. So they'd have to put a garage opening in that stone wall that was on the council's verge to get to access. Access to park off-site, and they were heard very close together, I think, and one commissioner approved it and let them have the parking, and the one two doors down or three doors down or whatever it said no, based on the evidence. And that then went to on appeal on a point of law, so similar to any other tribunal, to one of the judges in the Land Environment Court, and he, you know, I think quite reasonably have said that the decision's sort of been consistent, and found for the applicant who didn't get the parking. And the council then appealed that to the Court of Appeal, and the Court of Appeal said each decision has to be made on the very unique circumstances of that case, and that any seeming similarity between the two, which in these two were very, very similar, because both walls were identified as heritage items, is not as important as the commissioner dealing with the individual circumstances of each case. So I think that's another example, isn't it? The Siegel and Waverley idea that, yes, they might appear very similar, but there's always unique circumstances. So, yeah.
You agree with that assessment? There is really even...
Well, it's always, you know, like it's not a matter of agreeing or disagreeing. It's always sort of, you know, it's interesting, isn't it? Because some things like that wall, what was so fascinating about that case was it was almost identical. So these two, for example, the other one was a heritage item, this was a contributory item, but because it was a heritage item, that would give the solicitor for the applicant here some comfort that it was more likely to get the parking here. And look, I think, to be fair, it does sometimes depend who you get, and, you know, it shouldn't be like that, but it can be. It's just, you know, human nature. And you might be looking at all those, you know, that's why we try to make things as consistent as possible by having the planning principles, by giving weight to the development control plans when it's appropriate, and applying a reasonable amount of flexibility. But all those things try to make it as consistent as possible in terms of getting a decision. But as you know, that's why you're all going to be very busily employed soon, because nothing's, you know, perfectly predictable, and you don't know which way it's going to go. And, you know, that owner, if it was worth his while to... I mean, I might add, he did get a big extension at the back, and it was beautifully designed, and, you know, it was very contemporary and quite a few bedrooms. And so it was two stories. It had a big courtyard at the back, and so he got quite a significant development approved. It's just the parking particularly was the only thing that wasn't approved. So it still would have been a very lovely, livable house and, you know, 10 minutes to the city or something. So I think this is the last one. It's probably getting a bit tired of all these cases. This is a alts and adds to a contributory item. The reason this did go to arbitration, but I think it's a great example of where, so what it was they wanted to do an addition above, so rebuild the garage here, and there was an addition here. This is quite a wide site, and then it narrows down, I think. So for whatever reason, they couldn't really do it at the back. It was a contributory item to a... heritage conservation area again, and it's in Linfield. In this case, quite a lot of agreement was reached between the heritage experts during the conciliation. So this was a what's called a residential appeal. It went from it's under section 34AA of the Land and Environment Court Act. So it goes, you start on site at 9:30, you do conciliation. If the conciliation doesn't resolve into an agreement, then you terminate the conciliation and have a hearing held straight away. So often it can be done in a day, but generally about 2 days, and usually by lunchtime you can see it's not going to resolve in a into an agreement. So the matter then goes to a hearing. So this is one of those sort of fast-tracked versions for residential properties. So during the conciliation phase, the two heritage experts agreed on quite a number of issues and an amended design. So that amended design then, while they didn't entirely agree, there were still a couple of outstanding issues, so it had to go to a hearing. In the decision, I was able to use the agreement and the agreement on certain points of the design to hand down directions to the parties to then, so I made this person's version of that person's version of this. It was all done in drawings. I always do it, you can do it with conditions so that they're described, but in my experience as an architect, when you've got design changes in conditions, they often end up in another dispute sometime in the future, or it's very difficult for the certifier because you've got drawings that aren't exactly what consent's been given to. You've then got to look at the you've got to look at the conditions and work out what changes are done, and usually those changes are done in the construction certificate drawings or construction drawings. But for the certifier, it gets confusing, so I always think it's better just to get DA approval with the drawings updated to show what the actual consent is for. So I handed down directions for amended drawings, and then the parties, then I give them a timetable, or they agree to a timetable, they then bring back the drawings, file the drawings, and the council redoes its conditions, and then I can grant consent to those two together with the proposal properly shown in the drawings. And you can see it all works, and as per the agreement that was most of the agreement that was got during the conciliation. So, when you hear one party won and one party lost, it's never really in our jurisdiction. It's never really like that. It tends to be that you've got some amendments and the proposal isn't quite what it looked like when it first came in. There'll always be some changes, or so that's a very common outcome. So the council might be quite happy with it, even though the appeal's upheld, because they've managed to achieve whatever it was they were trying to achieve. This is one I believe the Chief Judge spoke to you about yesterday. So this was sand mine, I think, wasn't it? The project, so it was a third party appeal. So we only, as you might know, under the Environmental Planning Assessment Act, we only have third party appeals for designated developments. They're very big things, and it was a big sand mine, I think. And the project disturbance area would isolate a women's site, so and engravings located on the rock. So the interesting thing about this, because it was secret women's business, then all the experts and the parties had to either be female to see the site, or they had to have, so the barristers, I think there was a male barrister for one of the parties, but he had a junior barrister who was female and could then deal with the part of the hearing and the site visit that he wasn't able to visit. So this is an interesting issue in how they dealt with it. I think the developer sought, you'd have to read that. This is quite a long judgment, this one, you have to have a read, but it's an interesting one, and I think the Chief Judge probably gave you something more interesting yesterday about that, but it's really about impact on Aboriginal cultural heritage, so that's another area of heritage decisions that come before the court. Susan Dixon heard it, and with Sharon Sullivan. So Sharon Sullivan, that's an example. Sharon Sullivan is originally an archaeologist. She's amongst heritage experts, consultant. She's very well regarded and the most senior and most knowledgeable people, probably in Australia. And she's an acting commissioner, so she can come in, and she sat with one of the full-time commissioners and was able to deal with some of the Aboriginal heritage issues and impacts, so with her expertise. So that was, that's, you know, common.
I'm just wondering why an Aboriginal commissioner was refused to ask.
It might have been the issues in particular, or I mean, I think Sharon's got quite a lot of expertise in that area anyway. So, but I don't know what it might have been. Sometimes it's availability too. There's all sorts of issues. Yes. Yeah. It also might have been that it was more Aboriginal heritage as opposed to more contemporary cultural issues. I don't know if that's an appropriate distinction to make, but it might have been that, particularly because of Sharon and her archaeological expertise, might have been more pertinent to the issues in that particular matter than somebody probably with a different sort of background. But I don't know. I'm just tossing that in. So
the other thing with the secret women's business, which I was thinking, because I always felt very conscious because I'm not and have been initiated, but somebody who is working in the area pointed out that I could be the most appropriate next person, because, for example, Megan Davis, she's Aboriginal, she's very senior, but she wouldn't be privy necessarily to that information. And it's almost more difficult to allow her to be the man she's placed in a corporate position, whereas somebody like Sharon Sullivan, who has a lot of experience, but she's not, I believe she's not the company, she's the best place to make some specific tips and experience in planning issues. So trying to negotiate that space, maybe that's...
Maybe, yeah. Yes, I don't know. So I thought I'd talk a little bit about this. Is, you know, something that I think how we end up with some cases at the court. So there's a couple of cases, and I think it's interesting to have a look. This is really more planning, but for those of you who are interested in environment and planning law. So these are the maps. So I spoke earlier about the heritage and other maps that are in the local environment plans. This is Sydney City Council again. As I said, there's maps for land zoning, and it obviously reflects all the provisions and what's in the schedules of the LEPs, but it's a good way when you've got a site to have a look at, what the context is, I suppose. This is a site here, and I'll talk in a minute about that case, but so this is Potts Point in Elizabeth Bay. As probably everyone's fairly familiar with it. It's full of heritage items, very developed area, very high density. I think it's the highest density in all of Australia in this area. So when the council came to doing their 2012 LEP, they for this area, they got Alan Jack and Cottier, were a big architectural firm, and they got Godden Mackay Logan, who's a heritage architects or heritage planners, where I used to work, but I wasn't involved in this. They did some studies. So I think often with preparing these maps, there's a whole level of design and urban design that's missing. And in this case, it wasn't missing, fortunately. So these studies are proper master plans. They're based on what's on the ground. They went and had a look. They did great, detailed studies of what was there, and the idea of their studies was to inform what would happen in terms of the height of buildings map, which is obviously literally just what the height on each side is, and the floor space ratio. So I don't know if you understand floor space ratio is you take the floor. There's a definition in the LEP for how to measure floor space in a proposal, and then it's a ratio with the site area. So it's a very common planning speak to determine what the development potential of a site is. So a normal residential allotment, for example, would be 0.5 to 1, so half of the site area would be allowed to be developed in floor space, and then you might get up to 5 to 1 of things in areas with much higher development. It's very important when they do those studies that the height of buildings relates to the floor space ratio of the development potential of those sites, because often in our work we come across, and you think, I don't think anyone ever did that calculation and worked out. There's certain areas where you know, you might be able to reach the floor space ratio, but then you're way over the height limit and things like that. So there's obviously a lot more. It's a lot more complex than that, but these studies are, you know, essential and important part of council strategic planning. And in this case, I just wanted to put the two maps together. So this is the height of buildings. As I said, you'll see the heritage items, which are these, and sometimes they're like, this one is a two-storey development. It's called Manar. And it's a lovely early 20th century apartment buildings, which are, you know, sort of stepped down the hill. So this is the ridge running along here at Potts Point. This is Macquarie Street, and it drops down to Elizabeth Bay. And if you look at these sites over here, you'll see that that height is quite a lot. I think it was 15 metres. So it's the heritage items. If you look at that pattern and you look closely at the height map, you'll see that there's some reflection of this pattern in here, and that's what's so essential, and that's part of master planning and proper urban design, because what they've done here is they've gone, we want a wall of buildings here, these are reds, the highest, so when you look in the LEP, it's obviously got a legend that gives you all the heights. These are the highest buildings, so they wanted this wall of buildings along the ridge of Macquarie Street. They recognised this is the heritage item. Other buildings step down, so there's all these transitional zones. So there's a lot of information in there that, when you look at it, it just looks like a mass of colours. But when when you realise what's behind it, you can see that there's a lot of planning there. That it's about transitional space between heights of buildings, and all of that's also reflected in the floor space ratio for the sites. Now, I had a case, as I said, which was this site here, which is this one here, and it was a 1960s building that was quite a few floors, I think four floors below what it could have been in terms of the height map. But if you, and the application was for two additional floors, beautifully designed by a very good architect, two extra floors on this. Now, obviously that was going to be worth quite a lot to the building. They were then going to be able to refurbish the whole building with the money that they were going to make out of this development. But there's a, this was once a hotel and it was turned into apartments, and quite a number, maybe four or five of these apartments were going to lose their views over Elizabeth Bay. So it was a significant view impact issue. But because I was able to approve it, because these detailed studies had been done, it showed that that was what was anticipated, that LEP had been advertised and notified, so that there'd been community consultation as part of this process, that it was a known that that was the height of those buildings along Macquarie Street, and that's what was expected. So, I mean, that's just a little summary, but that's, and then also looking at tenacity, and I also found that the tenacity planning principle, which is really about a single, you know, home and views, is much harder to apply to apartments, because obviously some apartments might lose their view, but other apartments retain their views, and so on and so forth. So there's all sorts of issues that get teased out when you sort of get into these things, which makes it very interesting. So in contrast to that one...
Before you go on, you know, we were discussing earlier about, I mean, one of the aspects of law when we talk about transparency, accountability, that theoretically public going to be involved in that planning process, but most of us, including me, not necessarily realise the impact of the aspects of the LEP. That's also another strategic planning instrument. So in a sense, it's difficult to actually be involved unless you've got special expertise or access to special expertise. That's often challenge of
the
public and knowing exactly what
the
impact is going to be.
Would that be more in the hands of the architect or the solicitor to know that
we have all
the
time to
solicitor? So would that be more in the hands of the architect or the solicitor, or is it both?
In terms of the applicant with the two stories?
Yeah.
I think it's, you're right. I mean, they're a fairly educated group around there. I mean, if anyone was going to understand an LEP, it was probably, you know, some of those people. I mean, the other thing you can look at, this was the master plan and the plan for this area, and they wanted this height and these sort of development, and it's all about infrastructure too. So, you know, it's about the number of people that will be living here, public transport. So there's so many questions with planning and things that need to be taken into account. So all of this reflects what the occupation will be of a particular area. But you could also ask, should this person's development potential, given that there's been a proper study, there has been consultation, whether or not, yes, it is difficult to understand, but should a couple of apartments here be able to stop this developer reaching their development potential when that's, you know, and actually it was quite a bit under, it was two stories under what they could have done, so they, you know, they sort of, and it was done to the lowest floor to ceiling heights they could manage, so they, to make the impact as minimal as they could on those apartments, they did all sorts of things, like they brought it in so you still got views either side, and so there was a lot of ways that they'd thought about it. It wasn't just sort of, well, we want this and this is our, you know, these things I have a lot of negotiation about them.
If that is your apartment and you own that apartment and your view is then obstructed by this new development, is there any recompense? Or do you, if your application is rejected, you just have to live with it even if it reduces the value of your property?
Yeah, so the lesson there is when you go and buy things, have a good look around, have a look at the maps, have a think about things, you know, so... you know, views are, you know, I've seen this lots of times. It can be very distressing. I had one in Randwick, for example, where there was a proper, and again, a really good study done. It was actually done as a master plan with building envelopes, which I think is a much better system than having FSR. So you actually get an envelope and you can fill 70% of it. It was the town centre for Randwick. This developer had come and, so I had the site next door, which was the end of this little row. This developer had built apartments with these long balconies for two lots of apartments, which had incredibly panoramic views across to the airport and beyond, you know, great, great views. And these, all the living rooms, everything on this side of the development. And with knowing full well that the next site had exactly the same height and, you know, because they had the envelope right there. I think the council, you know, really has some duty of care not to approve that development with all those balconies. Of course, the developer built it, sold them all off with the great views and everyone believed. And next door was this little tiny house. But, you know, when I got that matter next door, and of course they were up in arms, and the owners of these apartments, and completely genuinely I understand that they, you know, but I think if you're standing on an apartment and you see a little house down there, it's worth thinking about what might happen to that in terms of your view, but yeah, look, often it doesn't. And what the developer of the site that I was dealing with had made a curve so that many of the apartments then got that sort of cone of view, so that the side that faced the apartment, so they'd tried very hard to retain some views for this developer, which was eating into the envelope that they had been given on the site. But these are common issues that end up at the court. So if all of this can be thought about ahead of time, and I suppose that's what I'm trying to say here, and I've got an illustration of the next one, which is the council area where it wasn't thought about at all, and how you then end up pushing these issues to the court, because that's when they get thought about. So this is Burwood, and not to particularly pick on Burwood, because there are many. This is the norm of, in my experience, of these maps. So these maps look as though lots and lots of effort's gone into them, and I think whoever did this map was sitting at their desk, never had ventured outside the council chambers with a colouring in pencil, and that was, you know, just drew a whole lot of donuts or something. It's just so naive and stupid. I can't fathom it. You'll see here are all the heritage items. Now, a lot of them in this area are, so this is really the town centre of Burwood in this area here. This is the train station. You'll see there's lots of little heritage items, but in the suburbs all around, and I've dealt with other ones outside of this map, there's lots of, you know, houses. It was a development, the area was developed, you know, again, Federation sort of period, similar to Strathfield. These are heritage conservation areas. But you'll see there is no sense of this map on that map. This is the FSR map, so similarly like the height map, it gives you an idea of what the development are. And so I think the area in the middle, this is 6-1, which means that's a very high development. You know, I can't remember what the height is, but so I had a little case, which was the old, and this was, again, this is how we end up with things. It's it creates, you know, expectations about development potentials of sites, because I think the, I can't remember exactly, that might be the site there, I think. So it was in the, it was in one of these, you know. So it had on it the old courthouse and the old police station, designed by Walter Liberty Vernon, one of Australia's best architects, who was another government architect, in the early 1900s. They weren't designed as a pair, but they were designed at different times. But of course, because they were both his work, he was an exemplary architect. They, you know, they had a very strong relationship between the two. Very sadly, what had happened is, I suppose Attorney Generals had then decided to build a new giant Burwood courthouse and a new giant Burwood police station, and they just like turned their back to these two beautiful buildings and chopped the back of one of them, of the courthouse, off, and then built these big boxes next door, and then decided to sell off this site instead of what they might have done. And if it had been done well, they would have integrated those buildings into this, into the development of the new police station, and perhaps you had given them a use related to that use, or still use one of the courthouses or courtrooms, because the courtrooms are the beautiful 1900 courtrooms. But that wasn't the case. So in all of the planning process, it was given a 26 metre height. These two buildings occupied the entirety of the site, so there wasn't a sort of postage stamp left to build your 26 metre. So why they ever got given that height and that FSR, you know, and so it creates this expectation. Of course, some developer brought it with the idea of, I'll just demolish those, or and it jeopardises the heritage items because it pushes that inevitable dilemma towards the court, and that's what happened. So the developer decides, look, I'll keep, I think with all the, it started off with, of course, demolishing both buildings and building the 26 metre development, and then and also, just interestingly, the police station, you know, had all their detectives, all the investigation rooms where they pin up all the material as part of their investigations, which is sort of, you know, we're all in there. So all these buildings would have overlooked, this building would have overlooked into, and then the police had an issue with that. So there was all sorts of issues there that, if a bit more thought and planning early on, wouldn't have ended up the way it did. But during the process of negotiation with the council, the developer decided to keep the courthouse, I think part of it, and demolish part of it, and then demolish the, I think this is right, I haven't, but demolish the police station, for example, and build the 26 metre, the 26 storey building. And that came to court, and, you know, on the basis of the heritage significance of the buildings, and really, you know, I refused it, but it had no, it didn't have anything like the development potential that the, and I know that one of the sort of mantras of planners is that, you know, your FSR and your height is not a right, but unfortunately it does create that expectation, and it'd be much better, instead of saying that, to have just got your maps right and have done what Sydney City Council did. And I know that takes resources and significant resources to do that, but the council spent significant resources defending this case. It would have been much better for everybody if that money had been invested early on in terms of strategic planning. So I just did want to make that point, that I think it's really, a lot of this can be dealt with, you know, really well, and with good design. And unfortunately, when it's not done that way, you do end up with... So we've had lots of cases in Burwood where they've upgraded it, upscaled the zoning to R4, which is high-density residential, and you'll have two heritage items, you know, and one block in between. Someone's building the, you know, the 13-storey apartment building in between. Of course, the two owners are, you know, irate. And you think, well, just some good planning and good strategic planning here would have avoided all of these issues for the council as well. So the last thing I was going to say was just to draw your attention to the heritage incentive clause, which is in all LEPs. It's a, if you know the process of the local environment plans that are now current at all, most of the, just about all of the councils, it was done with a standard template that was put out in, I think, about 2008, and most of them are made now. And those standard template had, the process there was to make the provisions more consistent across different councils. And there were compulsory provisions in the standard template, and one of them was clause 5, which is the heritage clause, and subclause 5.10 is the conservation incentives clause. Now, what it means is that if you've got a use that's not a permissible use on that site, you can get consent for that. Under this clause, you can get consent for a use that would otherwise not be a permissible use. It means that, for example, in a residential area, you can use, I've seen a heritage house used as a restaurant, for example, a restaurant that would not otherwise be permissible in that particular zone, but because they're able to use the heritage incentive clause. The flip side of it is that the applicant has to demonstrate that the use or that the an application under this subclause would provide for the conservation of the heritage items. So usually that means schedule of works and what they're going to do and how a conservation management plan or a heritage impact statement that demonstrates that the use is compatible and sympathetic and that it's going to give this heritage item a use that's going to allow it to be retained. So my experience is it's very narrowly interpreted by councils. Councils want, you know, they want the Araldine if you're going to be able to use it. They don't want, you know, any change. And I think that's not the right approach. I think we don't have very many incentives for the conservation of local heritage items like we do have for state heritage items, that there's a lot of scope for having greater incentives for people who do own heritage items, that perhaps as voluntary planning agreements to tie the conservation works for a local heritage item to a related development consent could be used much more often than it is, and they're things that are generated usually by the representative of the party of the applicant. So it's something probably in the lawyer's realm that could start to be used a bit more often, and I think councils should be using the heritage or encouraging the use of the heritage incentive clause much more often, and thinking about other incentives that they can provide to applicants. So that's it.
That's just a quick one. I was just wondering in regards to the expertise of commissioners, whether there's like been a growing trend towards certain fields of expertise.
Not really. I think in the Land Environment Court Act, it does say something about a range of expertise. So I suspect that when perhaps one or two commissioners leave and they've got a particular expertise, such as a legal background, then they might replace them with someone with a legal background. But the Chief Judge and his panel make that decision. So I presume that they look for a range and. But I don't know exactly what the criteria is. But yeah, there is criteria under I think it's Section 12 of the Land Environment Court Act.
I don't know how quickly we have to answer this. Maybe it'll be vetoed.
Looking to you.
But when we're looking, when you were showing us the FSR maps for the CBD, I was noticing where the Brain Root area comes up under that.
The what? The green? Oh, Barangaroo, yes.
And so I remember around this time last year, there was the issue over whether they were keeping the tower, things like whether they were keeping that tower that used to be used for signals and things like that, and how the continued protection of green space is going to happen. So I guess I was just wondering if you've had any thoughts generally on how that area is being managed with balancing the commercial interests and the heritage interest, because obviously it's a historical area because it's where all our original shipping was done and all of that.
Look, I probably wouldn't have enough knowledge about Barangaroo particularly to answer that question. There was a case on it, which is quite an interesting one, because the judge, Justice Biscoe, awarded you know, you might be aware of it. You probably know the name of it. Where the state government brought in legislation during the case and was able to win on that basis. It was about contamination of the land in Barangaroo, and Justice Biscoe awarded the costs to the winning party. So it's an interesting case from that point of view as a sort of signal.
I work very near there, and so I've seen a lot of the community posters where they're trying to fight against some of that development because they want to maintain the heritage feel of that area with all the houses and that down, especially
Miller's Point,
towards the Miller's Point end of like Kent Street and stuff like that. So I just thought that was
Well, I've had a tour of it. I've had a look, but I mean, I probably don't know any more than anyone else about it. We haven't had any particular cases. Yeah, no, that's fine. And it's always controversial, isn't it? When you know, it's an amazing site, and what a great opportunity for Sydney, and you know, you want it done really well. It's a big investment, and it's you know.
And it's also interesting because we've talked a lot about how there are a lot of presumptions around what would be treated as heritage, and we generally, I think one of our speakers, I can't remember who it was, one of our speakers yesterday said that there's kind of this, we jump to the presumption that the kind of heritage being protected will be like the pretty heritage, whereas like that site around Barangaroo was very industrial, so it's just, it's interesting thinking about.
Well, that's still very much valued,
How we look at how we value that industrial.
Yeah, well, it's all the same criteria they'll use, and often people have got expertise in different areas of heritage, so there will be people who have particular expertise in that particular, in industrial architecture and machinery and use and all those sorts of things. So I wouldn't say it was any less valued or that it'll just be a matter of going through that process. And of course, at some level, it's a little bit subjective as to how they, you know, deal with it, what gets kept, and you know, inevitably some people have an opinion it should be here, and on the other end of the spectrum some people are here, and it's just wherever it ends up being is a, you know, a political process. So, interesting.
I'll just make a comment on the first thing when you ask the question. It's so quick, really hard to work out exactly what you're asking just in terms of your camera. So you've got a good point to make on this regard. But I'm just thinking in terms of trends, not necessarily the random group, but often these big developments, they tend to put them in legislation, or they classify them, so ministers call them in and they decide what's happening. So in a sense, the public participation part of a development assessment is often controlled, and it's not as easy to be involved in, you know, protesting. So let's say you're talking about the juxtaposition of a development like that with a more traditional heritage, if you like, in terms of the rocks, and that's a good point. But often it's taken out of the realm of the public because it's put into a particular type of development, which is a big state infrastructure development, or it's special legislation that's passed. And if you read Dr. Jerry Bates's he updates his environmental law text so regularly that it's good. You're sure
not worth buying one. No,
you're sure to get the latest information.
That's true.
He actually has quite a significant part of a, I can't remember which chapter it is, but you think, maybe this is a one-off, but it actually has regularly happened over the years in terms of different types of development. So it's a technique of maybe skewing the development process for development, possibly, and maybe the public are excluded from that process, or it's restricted. So,
and inevitably, you know, you can never please everybody. I mean, that is a difficulty with planning. So it's always, you know, there's a whole spectrum of ideas, isn't it? Jerry, I did environment law with Jerry Bates, and he was, you know, for 6 whole days we had him, and it was just fascinating for the whole time. It was a great. And his book's very interesting.
To have him teach you if you go to Sydney Uni, I think he does a lot of the master's courses.
He does in environmental law, So when you do that mandatory course if you're going to do the environmental law course, he does the mandatory, I think this is called the environmental law plan or something like that. He's a great lecturer. He gives all the cases, you know, the stinky bats case, or you know, he gives them all cute little names.
Sorry, I hope you have time for one more. Just as a matter of interest, do you find that there are some local councils that are a lot better than others at conserving heritage, or are there some that are really bad?
Oh, sorry, we get cultures that at councils, you know, inevitably, and depends on who, you know, the council, well, the elected council themselves. So always remember the councils, there's council staff, which are, you know, the permanent staff, and then you've got the elected council, so they can act quite differently and independently. You might get things that go up as a recommendation for approval from staff. So the staff are professional, they're not, you know, they're apolitical, that'll go up, and then, you know, the reason, for example, we get a lot of childcare centres and brothels and all those sorts of things is because once you get a certain number of objectors, even if it's recommended for approval by the staff, because they'll just go through what, you know, it's a permissible use, they'll go through the amenity impacts and all that, and if they're satisfied with all of that, they'll recommend it for approval. But if you've got, you know, 50 or 100 objectors, and that was what causes that not to be decided by the delegated authority given to the staff, it'll go up to the elected council, and the elected council, once you've got a certain number of objectors, in my experience, just won't approve it because they're, you know, they're elected. I mean, that's inevitable, that's a political process. So, and that's commonly what happens with childcare centres, for example, and so we tend to get them because that's the way they can get approved, is to come to the court, and again, it's, you know, it's not political, we're looking at the same sorts of things that the staff are looking at. You know, is it permissible, and what are the impacts, basically? Of course there's cultures at councils, and council culture changes as the council, elected council changes, and they're very entertaining places if you've ever been to a council meeting. So
everyone should try.
Yes.